thanks for coming. Thanks for coming on such a wonderful day to hear such a wonderful speaker in such a wonderful building. This is amazing. We're very grateful for it. My name is Stephen Klingman. I'm from the English department. I'm also the director of the Interdisciplinary Studies Institute. We are an organization that every year develops a certain theme. Our theme this year is value, and this will be the event that kicks off our investigation of values through the year. I just want to say a few quick words of thanks before doing anything else. I want to thank our senior vice president in the UMass system, Dr. Marcelette Williams, who's here with us today, who helped start this event and helped fund it as well. And also our provost, Catherine Newman, and deans Judy Hayes and John Hurd for their support of the Institute. I'd also like to recognize our former provost, who had more than a little to do both with the Institute and with this building. So thank you very much. I'm now going to ask our new provost, Catherine Newman, to say a few words, and then I will return to introduce Albie Sachs.
Well, thank you, Professor Klingman, and good afternoon, colleagues. It's really wonderful to see such a great turnout for such a distinguished speaker. Over the last 5 years or so, I've had the great privilege of doing field research in South Africa for a book that I published last spring called After Freedom, The Rise of the Post-Apartheid Generation in Democratic South Africa. And through that experience, I developed a very strong bond and deep affection for the people of South Africa and for the extraordinary experience that they've had, especially over the last 20 years. Many of you know that this past spring was the 20th anniversary of the first free election in South Africa, a true watershed moment for one of the world's new democracies. And whatever complications have attended that history, I think there is an enormous amount to be proud of in the building of democratic institutions against a backdrop that many people would have predicted would never have made that possible. And it is owing to the tremendous strength and dedication of the people of that great country that they have managed to develop a set of democratic institutions that are responsive to the will of the people. And of course, as you will hear shortly from Professor Klingman, this owes a lot to the inspiration of our guest today. So I merely wanted to add my welcome to this fantastic event and to reiterate a very deep an abiding commitment that I think this campus has to the people of South Africa. In my last visit there in April, when I delivered a lecture at the University of Cape Town, I had the opportunity to meet with many of my many colleagues there in economics and sociology and all kinds of different fields. And one of the things they reinforced for me was the abiding commitment and connection they have to the University of Massachusetts at Amherst. There are many people who took their PhDs here who are teaching at the University of Cape Town, and they would love to see us continue to build that tie, deepen it, and increase the opportunities for exchange between our two countries and the students that we have going there and coming back. And that is something that I personally would really look forward to. Among other things, it would give me an excuse to go back, which I look forward to doing as often as possible. So thank you, Professor Klingman, for organizing this event, to the Institute for its inspiration. And I now give you back to him for the introduction.
So I want to begin my introduction for Albie Sachs by not talking about him. Instead, I want to turn to a moment from the famed Rabona trial of 1964, when Nelson Mandela, together with a number of his co-accused, was on trial for his life for his activities against the apartheid state of South Africa. Everybody knows of Mandela's great speech from the dock when he enunciated the principles he dedicated his life to and for which he declared that he was prepared to die. And there was indeed a very serious prospect of death sentences in the trial. The moment I want to think of, when the sentences were handed down and there were the defendants on capital charges waiting to hear their fate, the judge declared that Mandela and the others, Dennis Goldberg among them, were to be sentenced to life imprisonment. At that moment, Dennis Goldberg's mother, who could not hear properly, called out, asking what the judge had said. And Dennis, from the dock, turned to his mother and said, "Life, isn't life wonderful?" And of course, you know that I am, in fact, talking about Albie Sachs. For when Albie Sachs was blown up by a car bomb in Mozambique in April 1988, a bomb designed to kill him, as equivalent bombs had killed Ruth First and others, his response as he made his way through the cloud of unknowing that befell him was quite remarkable. Partly it was one of resistance, for his immediate thought was that he was being abducted by South African agents. But as he came to consciousness, even in that very moment, his response was not one of grief and despair. It was one of strange elation. He had survived. He found himself with a joke on his lips, a joke he could tell no one because he could not speak. And what that joke is, you'll have to read his book to find out. But this is my deeper point. Albie Sachs quite instinctively turned away from death and towards the elation of life. The damage that had been wrought would not bring his life to an end, but would become part of it, even a meaningful part of it, as he slowly recovered and moved his way into a quite extraordinary future. So that is one of my themes for today, and you can read about it in The Soft Vengeance of a Freedom Fighter, one of my favorite books of all time. And incidentally, that, as well as other books of Albie's, are on sale over here. So you really should buy them. Here's another theme, which emerges from Albie Sachs's equally remarkable book, The Strange Alchemy of Life and Law. Who better, one might ask, than someone who's been imprisoned unjustly to become a judge? Who better to know the strange ambiguity of the law itself? For the law can be used in all sorts of ways. Under apartheid, it was used for severe kinds of inhumanity and repression. There were laws of strict racial segregation, laws of dispossession, laws that encoded exploitation, as well as economic, racial, gendered, and sexual hierarchies of all kinds. There were laws that provided for detention without trial, for solitary confinement, that glossed over torture and murder. Albie Sachs suffered some of that directly. In the 1960s, he was detained not once, but twice without trial, the first time for 168 days, the second to be subjected to torture through sleep deprivation. It was subsequently that he went into exile, first in England and then in Mozambique, where he taught and was already thinking of a future dispensation in South Africa, what its laws and justice would be like. And that was where he was blown up by the car bomb. What was the response? You all know it. It was not for revenge, not to turn the laws against those who had abused his life and millions of others. Rather, his soft vengeance, as he called it, was to help create a society in which never again would such injustice be possible. It was to be a society in which even if those who had tried to kill him were put on trial and there was not sufficient evidence to convict them, they would walk free. The ambiguity of the law would be no more, or if that ambiguity could not be completely overcome, it would be mitigated, humanized, transformed. How all this came to pass is an extraordinary story, and one which never becomes tired in the telling, because it is a story of hope, one we can still use in the world we've created and which surrounds us today. For Albie Sachs, it meant return to South Africa. Indeed, not all that long after the bomb in 1998, because by 1989, the ANC was unbanned and the prisoners were beginning to walk free and the negotiations would begin that led to the undoing of it all. Albie Sachs was involved in those negotiations and even more importantly, in the fashioning of the South African Constitution and the Bill of Rights. One of the best constitutions, if not the best, in the world, with its protections for all of whatever race, creed, color, gender, or sexuality. In 1994, Nelson Mandela appointed Albie Sachs as judge on the Constitutional Court, the highest court in the land. There with his colleagues, he participated in landmark decisions, many of them revolving around key questions of dignity. There, Albie Sachs delivered the judgment that guaranteed the right to same-sex marriage. Here in Massachusetts, it was another South African, Margaret Marshall, who presided over the court that provided the same guarantee. In South Africa, almost single-handedly, Albie Sachs gathered together a collection of artworks that now adorn the Constitutional Court, so that the People's Court should be graced not only in justice, but in beauty, the art of justice indeed. Albie Sachs has been honored in many ways. There are multiple honorary degrees. He has a lyrical and accomplished patent award twice, South Africa's highest award for nonfiction. And if you'll permit me my little joke, I can tell you that I've won that award once. So my mathematics tells me that Albie is exactly twice as good a writer. Most recently, Albie was announced as the first ever winner of the Tang Prize in the Rule of Law for, quote, his many contributions to human rights and justice globally, and for his efforts in the realization of the rule of law in a free and democratic South Africa. The Tang Prize is known as the equivalent of the Nobel. this is true and just recognition indeed. I feel I've had a long association with Albie Sachs, if not always in person, then through his books. I remember when I was a graduate student in England, reading the jail diary of Albie Sachs, looking over my shoulder as I took it off the shelves, because those were the days when the book was banned in South Africa and there were spies everywhere else. That is partly why it's in a special pleasure to welcome him to UMass today. But this is where I want to bring my two themes together, Albie's story of personal healing and the healing of South Africa, and perhaps add a third, the healing that we too can be part of. But let's face it, the world we currently inhabit is one not only of joy, but also one of serious damage. How do we turn a history of damage into a future of justice? How do we do so not by ignoring the damage, but by bringing it into our understanding of the present and the world we would like to see emerge, the people we would like to become? How do we do so through a set of values to guide us? Without laying too heavy a burden on Albie's shoulders, who better to help guide us than a person who has not only understood that, but has lived it in personal, social, legal, and historical terms? Who better, in short, than Justice Albie Sachs? Please join me in welcoming him to the University of Massachusetts.
Não basta que a nossa causa seja justa e pura. Justiça e pureza deve existir entre nós próprios. Anybody here speak Portuguese? Understand it? It's not enough that our cause be just and pure. Justice and purity must exist inside ourselves. These were lines when I was learning Portuguese in newly independent Mozambique that impacted very profoundly on me by Jorge Rebelo, one of the persons who'd given up his studies to join Frelimo and join in the liberation of Mozambique. It's not enough that our cause be just and pure. Purity and justice must exist inside ourselves. It resonated with me then, and it's the introduction to the presentation I'm making today. And possibly, Stephen, I don't know the status of your thematic on values, but possibly an introduction to this year of interdisciplinary investigation of values and the importance of values in society. And I begin with, I'm sitting in my office in Maputo, Mozambique, in the Ministry of Justice. It's very hot, we're working very hard, long hours. The phone rings and I'm told President Oliver Tambo is on the line to speak to you from Zambia, from Lusaka, Zambia, president of the ANC in exile. I'm very curious and rather flattered. I pick up the receiver. Hello, Comrade Albie, how are you? I'm fine. What's the weather like? It's okay, it's hot. How's the work going? African style, you don't rush into things, you establish a connection. And I'm wondering, what's it about? And he said, an issue has cropped up where we feel you might be able to be of some assistance. Is there any chance that you could come to Lusaka to help us? And he said, I know your work is important and it might be difficult, and if you can't make it, please just say so. But if it helps, I'm willing to speak to President Samora Machel to facilitate. Now, normally inside the ANC in those days, you'd get a phone call that would say, Comrade Albie, there's a colloquium in Greenland next Friday. You be there and bring a 30-page paper with you. And here's the president of the organization saying, are you available? Could you possibly do it? If you can't, I understand. And of course, you want to say, take me. So a week later, get off the plane in Lusaka. I'm driven down to the little office in which the ANC functioned. I'm wondering, what's it about? He's sitting in his office, and I noticed he's actually got a rolled up piece of newspaper and he's swatting flies. And I'm feeling, you know, the president of the organization leading the freedom struggle in South Africa shouldn't be swatting flies. But I don't know who else should be doing it. But in any event, the story that follows is punctuated by and he asks after my health and the situation in Mozambique and what's it. And eventually he says, we have a problem in our organization. We have a number of people who we have taken captive. And there's nothing in the statutes of the ANC about how you deal with captive prisoners. Now, most political organizations don't have a section that deals with, if you're in the Democratic Party, what do you do with Republican captives? And he had drafted the Constitution, in fact, that version in 1958, while it was still legal in South Africa, there was nothing. And he said, we don't know what standards to use in dealing with captives. And these are people who've been sent by the enemy to destroy the organization. We have strong indications against them. How do we deal with them? And in my jaunty way, lawyer-like way, I say, well, there are international standards that are very clear. No torture, no inhuman or degrading punishment or treatment. He said, we use torture. We use torture. We're fighting for freedom and we use torture. He said it with a bleak face. I can't believe it. He didn't explain the background to me. It emerged afterwards that in Angola, which itself was convulsed by civil war, where the ANC had its camps, where it was training guerrillas to go back and fight for freedom in South Africa, a number of people had been infiltrated, sent by Pretoria to destroy the organization, to put drugs and poison in the food, to spike the ammunition, to blow up the leadership. It was quite serious. And now they were captive. And it turned out that the people who were caught in that way were being beaten up by the guards. The guards were people of 19, 20, 21 who'd given up their studies at high school and left university to go out, get a gun and return and fight for freedom. And what do you do with captives? Everybody knows. You do to them what they've been doing to us. You beat them up. And there was an outcry against that. Mandela received the report. He set up a commission to inquire. And the commission had reported, yes, indeed, the prisoners were being abused in that way. And now he's asking me, what should we do? And I could see that sense of relief when I referred to the international instruments. No torture, no inhuman degrading punishment or treatment. And the next thing is I'm commissioned to prepare a code of conduct for the ANC to deal not only with those people, but with all the problems the organization had in exile for many, many years. And we had problems of, it could be somebody at a meeting, a branch meeting. They come drunk, they insult the chair, they mess things up. You don't bring the whole weight of the organization against them. You have to use political means to try and resolve that. These are people who are nuisances and irritations, but you've got to find an appropriate prophylactic. But then you've got people who drive the vehicles of the organization when they're drunk, who assault members of the organization or people outside the organization, physical assault, they get into a fight, sexual assault. That's serious. What do you do about it? How do you handle it? And the host countries are saying, don't bring your problems to us. You deal with it. We've got enough problems of our own. That's for you to decide as a liberation movement in exile. And then you have the most serious class of cases of people who are being sent in to destroy the organization. I did what was probably the most important legal work of my life, drafting in effect it's called the Code of Conduct, a code of due process for a liberation movement without courts, without police force, without lawyers, without prosecution authorities, something that we could manage, that would be meaningful, that would give some kind of legality, some kind of due process to dealing with these issues inside the organization. Basically setting up tribunals, charges being presented, people having the right to defense, to bring their own evidence, and the basis on which people can be found responsible and held accountable, and a very limited range of penalties that could be applied. But then what to do about the most serious? And there, again, a special kind of tribunal. And although the code of conduct refers to the ANC's traditional hostility to capital punishment, nevertheless, in the circumstances in which we are fighting, it's not excluded, but it's expected that the traditional opposition to capital punishment will be borne in mind. And in fact, people who were sentenced to death for having been spies sent in to destroy the organization, Oliver Tambo commuted all their sentences. So some people had been executed before that, but after that it stopped altogether. The code is put to a conference of the ANC in a little town called Kabwe in Zambia. I remember so vividly the hall in which we functioned, in which we met, surrounded by Zambian troops, in case South African commanders come in to blow us all up. And we're discussing a code of conduct, amongst other things, to introduce legality inside the organization. And I'm asked to present the code to the delegates. And my heart's going boom, 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 boom. The general structures, people are very comfortable with that. There's no problem with that. They feel it's kind of balanced and let's give it a try. But the issue I presented fairly and squarely is it permissible to use what was called intensive methods of interrogation in extreme circumstances, a so-called ticking bomb situation? And it was important that the organization take a decision as an organization. I knew what Oliver Tambo's views were, but he wasn't the kind of president who said, I believe in this, and this is my order, and that's what the organization has to do. He wanted it to be something that the delegates assumed, they discussed it beforehand, they undertook, and committed themselves, so that it becomes part of the culture, the philosophy of the organization. And I don't know how people are going to respond. We had people from the army, people from our diplomatic groups all over the world, people doing secret underground work in South Africa. How are they going to respond? The first person up onto the very high platform was a young soldier from Kwantu, where he's the armed wing of the ANC. He said, no torture. No matter what words you use. He said, if you give security the tiniest bit of leeway, they never stop there. It has to be absolutely clear. No torture. And then he's followed by another young soldier. Probably they didn't survive. There were years of hard struggle. Chances are they were killed in the struggle. But he gets to the platform, he takes the microphone, and he says, we are fighting for life. How can we be against life? My heart just swelled. That captured everything. We are fighting for life. How can we be against life? That's who we are. That's the idealism that holds us together. That's that core set of values that distinguishes us from the people, from the oppressors. It's not just we have a different political philosophy. It's not just that we believe in democracy. It's because we are freedom fighters with freedom in our hearts. And that is extremely powerful. And if we surrender that, we're giving up, if you like, our strongest weapon, which is our internal sense of coherence, of dignity, of the justness of the cause that we're doing, the justice that exists inside ourselves. And I just felt fantastic. It's easy for me I've been educated in the legal tradition. We follow international law and these standards. I've come from a relatively comfortable background. Here was this young African guy in the military facing being in the trenches, and he's saying, we're fighting for life, how can we be against life? And we unanimously accepted no torture. And I mention that because I hear discussions in this country about torture, yes or no, or maybe, or a little bit of torture. I hear it coming from very high up people. And not only in the time of the previous president, even today. And the argument I hear against torture, the main argument is it's unreliable. I wish it was unreliable. So many of our people suffered so much. They gave away often important information. It didn't destroy our organization. It strengthened our organization. We knew that there was no other way. We had to come together. We're fighting a ruthless enemy. Our values have to be stronger. We have to be stronger than them. It didn't destroy us. It might have given them temporary victories, temporary information to catch a few more people. But it didn't destroy our resolve at all. But you don't torture, not simply because of what it does to the people who are being tortured, but what it does to you. What it does to your dignity, not just the dignity of the person who's suffering. Because then you are reducing yourself to the ranks, to the value system of the people you're fighting against. You're giving them a huge victory in that sense. You're saying the only difference between yourselves and us is who is the strongest, and we're going to show you that we are mightier than you are. And you're giving away your most powerful ingredient that makes you who you are, your set of core values. And I mention this because it went together with other aspects of Oliver Tambo's philosophy that became, emerged as the philosophy of the organization. The question of terrorism in South Africa. At the time in the late 1960s, when the Black September movement, infuriated by the treatment of Palestinians in Jordan, by the Jordanian government, went in for hijacking. Leila Khalid became an internationally known figure. She's still quite prominent today as a hijacker. And members of the ANC were saying, why don't we do this? What's the matter with our leaders? Are they scared we'll be called names? Are they afraid to take action? And people like Oliver Tambo said no. The leadership said, no, we don't do that. It's not simply because we don't know who else might be on the plane. It wasn't just that. It's not simply because you are playing into the hands of those who want to demonize you, not as freedom fighters, but simply anarchists and terrorists. It's not simply for that. It's not even primarily for that. It's because of who you are. If you are attacking civilians, what are you doing to yourself as a freedom fighter? We just don't do that. And I emphasize these points not simply because the theme of this conference is values. It's not long after the death of Nelson Mandela, and he is projected as the man who miraculously and marvelously saved South Africa, coming out of jail without any hatred in his heart after 27 years and leading the country to freedom and reconciliation. Mandela was fantastic. We were so proud of him. We're still so proud of him. But he didn't create the culture that produced the transformation that seemed to be miraculous. He embodied it. He articulated, he contributed towards it. Oliver Tambo, his legal partner, the person leading the ANC in exile, was his equal in style and grace and dignity in every way. And he was the one holding, if you like, the ring externally, ensuring that all voices were heard, that the organization maintained its core values, its core integrity, and saying, we don't go for civilian targets and the people we are. And if we do that, we will never have a country in South Africa. And that's where the miracle of South Africa came. That's where our constitution came from. The basis was laid in the freedom struggle days. We did bad things in the freedom struggle. We did torture people. Some bombs were used against civilian targets, but overwhelmingly it was repudiated, it was denounced, it wasn't the main policy. And when it came to the captives, after this decision was taken, I didn't hear of any stories afterwards. There might have been abuses, but we transformed it completely. And that shows you're not helpless victims of history. You give leadership, you take policy decisions, you follow through, and you can make a difference. I fast forward to the Mohammed case. It's now Judge Albie Sachs wearing a green gown on the Constitutional Court of South Africa. With one of those cases, you get them in law school, hypothetical in textbooks, but it's an actual case we have to decide. It was after the blowing up of the American embassy in Tanzania. 65, I think, people were killed, mostly Tanzanians. It's an act of mass murder. These are terrible. We didn't know the term Al-Qaeda in those days, but it was one of their actions. Mohammed, apparently, played a part in organizing the explosives and getting the bomb placed, moved into the embassy. He comes down to South Africa, according to the evidence, under an assumed name. He claims political asylum. He's given immigrant status and he works in a bakery. Apparently he was a very good baker. Young, pleasant, amiable person. Quite important in a way. It would be easier if he was a monster, then you don't have to explain anything. Any event, one day he is locked up. The owner of the bakery wants to know what's going on. Asks the police, goes to the prison, says, I want to give him a lawyer. They say he can't have a lawyer. And within 36 hours, he's flying on a hired plane to New York, plane hired by the FBI to face a trial for murder. And the New York court has got jurisdiction because it's Americans killed in the American embassy. Meanwhile, the baker's gone to court. The high court says, there's nothing I can do. He was here under a false name. He got a permit in an irregular way. He's been deported. You're out of court. The baker feels there's something wrong here. Why wasn't I told? What's going on? Is this the kind of country we're living in? He comes to the Constitutional Court. And we hear the arguments. And it's open terrain for us. The Constitution doesn't deal directly with that sort of situation. But there are two things that concern us as judges. There's no problem about extraditing somebody who's committed or alleged to have committed such a terrible offense. In fact, you want extradition. You want accountability, of course. He has to be caught and he has to pay his debt to the law. But there are two problems. Why wasn't he allowed a lawyer? And the argument basically was because the case was so serious, he can't have a lawyer. The second was, in addition, it was said, and we read the words, what's the term that was used for the evacuation of people?
Extreme rendition.
Rendition. The word rendition for the first time. It's a nice word, rendition. What the heck does it mean? It's extradition. We know what that means. Deportation, we know what that means because there are laws dealing with it. Rendition means just handing over. Kidnapping, that doesn't sound very good. And we are distressed as a court. We have due process. There could have been extradition. Proper procedures for deportation could have been followed. They weren't. He was just whipped off in that way. But there was something even more substantial. Our court had decided that capital punishment violated our constitution, violated the fundamental value system of our constitution. That for the state to cold-bloodedly take a person, whatever that person might have done, and put a rope around that person's neck and strangle that person to death was a violation of human dignity in a way that was inconsistent with the values of our new constitutional order. And we declared that, and 400 people on death row were now resentenced, no more executions in South Africa. And here he was being handed over to the United States to face a capital charge. Somebody else who'd been in his clandestine group in Tanzania had ended up in Germany. And in the case of Germany, the United States applied for extradition. The judge in charge said, we will extradite the accused, sure, but you have to give us an assurance that if found guilty, he will not be executed. Because just as we don't hand over people to countries that use torture, we don't hand over people to countries that use the death penalty. Then we become complicit in something that we are constitutionally opposed to. We're not saying you can't have the death penalty in the United States. That's your issue. But we're saying we don't hand over somebody for possible execution. But we were South Africa, not Germany. You know that country at the bottom of the African continent? I can speak for myself, that sense of indignation. We'd fought so hard for the rule of law, for doing things correctly. And here's the country that is claiming to be the apostle of the rule of law in the world, using rendition, a backdoor method of whipping people away. And here were our officials conniving at it, feeling, wow, you know, something to go home and tell your family. I worked with the FBI, I sent this mass murderer over to the United States. And so we made a declaration saying that A, Mr. Muhammad, we always called him Mr. Muhammad, had been denied his rights of legal counsel, number one, and number two, he should not have been handed over for trial in the United States without an assurance being gained that if found guilty, he would not be executed. What to do? We couldn't send a gunboat from Cape Town to New York to promise to shell Wall Street or wherever the trial court was in the way that used to happen in the 19th century if, heaven forbid, an American was put on trial in China or a Frenchman or a German or a Brit. So we simply sent a copy of our judgment to the judge who was presiding, a very thoughtful judge, and I believe he read it, and the jury, I'm not sure if they were made acquainted, but the jury realized the guy from Germany, they'd both been found guilty, now it's the sentencing phase, just on the question of capital punishment or not, he cannot be sentenced to death. And half the jury said this guy also shouldn't be sentenced to death. Now the date was quite important. It was August 2001. If it had been a month later, I don't know what the decision would have been. But the point was that we as judges, and we were unanimous on this, felt it's particularly important at times of stress that you hold firm to your deep values in your society. And we put the emphasis very much on our officials. We didn't want to look as though we are pointing a finger at the great United States of America. You guys will have your own internal debates here. That's for you to decide. And we don't want to be uppity in that sense. But we are making a statement to Africa, to the world, to the United States, that something new is happening. in Africa, in Southern Africa. And we, as guardians of the Constitution, must be the ones upholding these new values. So foundational. A value is not just a taste or preference. There used to be a great battle between Pepsi and Coke, and you prefer the one to the other, and some like chocolate cake and others like cheesecake. It's not at that level at all. And what's interesting also is, if you looked at our court, we came from such different backgrounds. Probably the majority on the court were believers. They derived their ethical foundations from the Bible, in most cases, possibly from Quran. Some of us were very secular. We had our own ethical principles derived from our lives and sense of values, what it means to be a human being. Some of us had been lawyers from an early age, worked our way up on the bench, been successful practitioners, had written books on criminal procedure. Others of us had been in the resistance, had been in jail. Pius Lange, who became the Chief Justice afterwards, we're driving through Durban one day, and we passed a little building. He said, "Oh, Albie, that's..." He's not taking me there, he's just passing there. That was the native pass office. He just remembered when he was 16, he had to go there to get his pass. And he said they stripped us naked. They felt our testicles. It wasn't nice. They hosed us down. It wasn't nice. He said, "But you know, you're young, you're 16, you're getting on with life. You can take it. That's life." But he said, to see people the age of my father going through that, he said, that I couldn't take. Now, I couldn't... I'd been in jail, I'd been blown up, but I couldn't relate that kind of experience, which was the experience of the majority of our people in our country. But we're all sitting on the one bench. So how do we share a value system? It's not simply derived from life experience or even from professional experience. It's derived from the way in which, as legal people, you filter, you refract from all the light pouring in through the prism of the Constitution, the values of the Constitution. We'd all worked on the Constitution. How can we have a basic compact for our society? The Constitution as the foundational system of public norms that impact on all exercises of public power, not just on the way judiciary functions, but it's the regulator of all exercises of public power in that constitutional form. Believers, non-believers, English speakers, Afrikaans speakers, Zulu speakers, that's not the issue. People who were born into poverty, people who had to carry a pass, people who were born into comfort and luxury, that's not the issue. The issue is this compact, this concentrated set of distilled values in the text of the Constitution becomes the mechanism, the medium, the prism through which we reflect and come to our decisions. And it's a document that we don't simply interpret literally. In the old days, the Oxford English Dictionary was the most important instrument a lawyer had. And if you didn't find the interpretation you wanted through the Oxford English Dictionary, you would go to, forget, Chapman's or whatever the others were, until you found one that suited your case. Now, we don't use dictionaries. We use history. We use our knowledge about the pains of our society. We use the theme of never again. We use the sense of why we have a constitution, what the constitution means to ordinary people. And all of that is that concentrated value system incorporated in a set of principles, of protections, and of institutions and procedures. So that's what emerges in a way. I gave you the example of the case where we decided. But what happens when you have grossly divergent value systems in the society and the issue comes before the court and people are claiming their fundamental rights and they say there's no legislative backing for our fundamental rights? And I'll tell you another story about myself. It's 1991. I'm driving in November, which is high summer for us, to the center of Cape Town, and I'm sweating. I'm sweating because it's hot. I'm sweating because I'm driving with my left. I haven't been driving for very long. I'm sweating because I don't know the way very well. I've been in exile for 24 years. But above all, I'm sweating because I'm going to go on a gay pride march. And I'm feeling awkward. And I'm saying to myself, oh, why can't they have a poster that says Straights for Gays? And then I feel ashamed of myself. If you're going to go on the march, you go on the march. And I'm late. And I get into town and I see the marchers coming towards me. And the first poster I see says, suck, don't swallow. Oh my God. I'm in the newspaper tomorrow for sure. I park the car, I get out, I run along, and I find myself marching next to Edwin Cameron, then a professor of law, now one of the great figures on our constitutional court. And I feel proud. I feel proud of myself. I feel proud that I've broken through a barrier of awkwardness and embarrassment, and that I'm marching side by side with people who are claiming their fundamental rights. We go to a little park not far away. I'm asked to say a few words, and I say, when I was a child, I used to come to this park and only whites could sit on the benches. Black nannies could come and wheel the children, but they couldn't sit on the bench next to their charges. But there could have been signs up saying straights only, because if a couple of the same sex were holding hands, were cuddling, were enjoying being in the park together, the police would be onto them. And I said the theme of rights of same-sex people is important not just for a section of our community that's been subjected to abuse and marginalization. It's fundamental to South Africa. If we can't handle difference, then we finish as a country, because difference has been used to keep us apart. Apartheid was based on the apartness of people who looked different, spoke different languages, had different ancestry. And now we want a nation of citizens, of human beings. So in a sense, this was a touchstone of something much wider than simply the traditional embedded forms of discriminating against people because of their sexual orientation. Fast forward, that was 1991. 2005, Judge Albie, in my suit now, at the court sitting round our table, and Pius said, Chief Justice, he's just got an invitation from a body called Lawyers, Christian Lawyers for Africa. They're having a conference during the court recess. They've invited him to attend. He says he's going to be away on some business elsewhere. Is there anybody who can go? Pius, I'm on court duty, but I don't think I'm the right person. He said, Albie, you're just the right person. And I understood what he meant. He meant if he goes, he's Christian, he's a lawyer, he's from Africa, it looks like a sectarian identification. If I go, then I'm speaking for the court, for the institution. Any event, a couple of weeks later, it's April, it's cool, I'm not sweating, but I'm feeling uncomfortable, I'm being driven to this meeting. I come in and partly I'm uplifted. The beautiful costumes of Africa, the diversity is just something fine in itself. But what should I say? And I feel I can't simply say, on behalf of the Constitutional Court, welcome, I hope you have a good conference. That's disrespectful to the conference and disrespectful to us. We are people of conscience. We think about the world. There should be some connection that's more meaningful. So I tell them the story about my taking the oath. And we're being sworn in, and Sachs, I'm alphabetically challenged, so we go through all the others first, and I'm wondering, what should I do? I grew up in a very secular home, and it was important for me. I was shaped more by questions of conscience than by questions of race. My mother worked for Moses Katani, an African leader. The issue of race wasn't an issue for me. It was clearly racism was unacceptable. But the issue of pretending a belief that I didn't have, I was saying to myself, will be disrespectful to me and disrespectful to God if God exists. And I can't do it. And it was very tough and very lonely taking that decision. And I tell this to the Christian Lawyers for Africa. And I say, now it's my turn to take the oath. And should I affirm, like some of my colleagues did, in which case you just say, I affirm, or raise my right arm and say, so help me God. And it comes to Sachs, and I said, I raised my right arm, and I said, so help me God. And I said that because I wanted to honor Ruth First, who died through a car bomb, through Joan Harvey, who was assassinated, Rix Marshall-Wandley tortured to death, Elijah Lawser tortured to death. That was the oath I wanted to take. And I put my arm down. They stood up and gave me a standing ovation. And I thought they'd be cross. I'm raising my arm for a purely secular instrumental purpose to make a political point. They didn't see it that way. The next day I'm taking them on a tour of the Constitutional Court, about 70. Wonderful building. And right in the heart of the prison where Gandhi and Mandela were locked up. And that's where we've got the court that now stands for never again, no more repression. This beautiful, elegant building with light coming in and a feeling of warmth and invitation to everybody who goes there. And I'm late. And I'm due to speak at the women's jail where the Commission for Gender Equality are having a meeting. And I'm about to run off and they say, no, we must say a prayer. Now some prayers are quite quick. Some prayers go round the world a few times, and this went round the world a few times and I'm late. But I took it from them because they were giving what they had to give. I could receive the gift without believing in the prayer in a philosophical sense in the way they did. And I'm about to rush off and they say we must lay on hands. 70 pairs of believing hands on the secular body. It takes a long time. Now I tell you the story because this was just before the same-sex marriages case came to our court. And I'm asked, after hearing the argument by Pius, to write the lead judgment for the court. I'm not consciously thinking, which side am I on? Who do I please? Where do I belong? But unconsciously, in my subliminal area, there's a knowledge of, here are people marching for their fundamental rights, and I'm marching with them. But there are also millions of people, many, many more people, like the Christian Lawyers for Africa, who have a totally different worldview and who feel threatened and upset and challenged by the whole notion of same-sex couples being married. And in the debates that we had in our court, the big fight was about the M word. Even opponents of same-sex relationships acknowledge under our constitution that includes sexual orientation. I think it's still the only national constitution in the world. In South Africa, of all countries, says sexual orientation is one of the forbidden grounds of unfair discrimination, along with disability, race, color, creed, and so on. So they acknowledged that at that stage, we'd already declared the crime of sodomy to be unconstitutional. They acknowledged that people could make domestic partnership arrangements that the law would uphold, that the law could provide protection and non-discrimination, they said, but don't call it marriage. We religious groups created marriage long before the state took over, and marriage has a defined meaning. And the one advocate even quoted from scripture, but not emotionally, he wasn't ranting. You could feel he was believing what he was saying. He was coming to court to say how he saw the world and how he would feel that somehow this would be undermining marriage as he understood it if same-sex couples could participate in the same institution. Then the question was, what do you do? And we were unanimous in the court that to deny same-sex couples the opportunity to express their love, the intimacy, the acceptance of mutual responsibilities, and public acknowledgement in the same way that heterosexual couples have is a very gross denial of their claims to dignity. It's very exclusionary. We didn't strike down the marriage law. The marriage law said, I, A, B, take you, C, D, to be my lawful husband stroke wife. That would have been of the graveyard. Then no one can have a marriage if same-sex couples aren't included. We wanted equality of the vineyard, this terminology we actually got from American legal writers on some other topic. When you have under-inclusive law, do you get equality by denying the benefit to everybody equally or finding a way to give the benefit to everybody equally? We decided we have to follow the latter. We indicated that separate but equal had shown itself, it was never equal, and the very notion of separation imposed a dignity, saying you are not worthy, you don't belong, you have to be excluded and marginalized. And so we held unanimously that this was a violation of the fundamental rights to equality, a violation of dignity, as well as of privacy of the people concerned. There was some question about, should we rewrite the law itself, I, A, B, take U, C, D, to my lawful husband, stroke wife, stroke spouse. And my colleague Kate O'Regan wanted to follow that route, and she had some precedent of ours to support her. But 10 of us, with myself writing, said, no, we want to involve Parliament. We want to involve the legislature. We don't want this to appear like a court-imposed married. Okay, you guys are married, but you're not really married. This is a court kind of marriage that's specially for you, this little powerful lobby group. And we felt Parliament is as obliged to uphold the Constitution as the courts are. It's their duty, it's in the Constitution, which they had written before. They must uphold it. And there was a belief that our nation would respond, if there was a public debate, that our Parliament would respond. And that was a bit of a risk that was taken. But if Parliament didn't do it, we wrote in, within a year, then the words would automatically, or spouse, would be written in. So it wasn't giving Parliament an option as to whether, but it was giving a choice as to how. And in the end, on the, kind of the day before the last day, by a huge majority, with a massive vote, because the ANC whip insisted, do you use the word whip here?
Yes.
Whip insisted on a vote, it was a matter of principle, a law was passed that allowed same-sex couples to say, I marry you, the M word was used. Now what I'm going to conclude with, however, is not simply the decision, which came a bit later than Moggy Marshall's decision here in Goodridge. And we didn't cite it. We didn't want to get caught up. We weren't an extension of the American debate. We were applying our constitution, our sensibility, our sense of human dignity in our country. But the issue was, what about this question of the two worldviews? And a large portion of the judgment, we use the word judgment, you'd say opinion, is devoted to the relationship between the sacred and the secular, and arguing for coexistence between the two, and saying that in terms of the secular law, same-sex couples have the right to public recognition and the use of state institutions to have their love and intimacy recognized and acknowledged in the same way, incontrovertible. And the M word is not just symbolical. It's very meaningful in a cultural sense. The intangibles sometimes are more important than the tangible. It's not just tenancies and inheritance. It's celebrating your anniversaries. It's being recognized as part of the mainstream. There was some queer literature that even objected to the idea that now we're selling out to heteronormativity. But overwhelmingly, the feeling was, we want the choice. It's for us to decide if we want to be able to express our relationships in the same way that same-sex, heterosexual couples can do. But then the judgment goes on to speak about the importance of religion, not as simply something that you're entitled to do in private as an individual, but as part and parcel of the temper of the nation. Now, maybe I could write more easily because I am so convincedly secular in that sense. It doesn't mean non-spiritual or non-respective of norms and ethics and so on. It just comes in a different intellectual format. And saying, and it was so much in our country, when we were debating the preamble to the Constitution's invitation, he said, all you have to do is persuade the ANC to have a preamble to the Constitution that says in humble submission to Almighty God. And then millions of people will regard you as a hero. I thought, I can't. In humble submission to Almighty God. It's so exclusionary to non-believers. It's compelling you to bend the knee. It's so violatory of conscience of people who don't want to humbly submit to Almighty God, but who want to accept the ethical principles and values in the commandments and so on. So I came up with a proposal that we say, Nkosi Sikelel' Afrika, God bless Africa. That's our hymn. It was the hymn of struggle. We used to sing it together, believers and non-believers alike. It was the hymn of the oppressed people that now becomes the hymn of the nation. And the preamble says, Nkosi Sikelel' Afrika, God bless Africa, Morena Baloka Setshaba sa Isizwe, God sien Afrika, in the official languages. Now that's trying to find a way. It's not the strict separation of church and state that was very meaningful in the United States in a particular time of its history that's been controversial since then. It was the South African way. And now I'm thinking of Advocate Smythe, who stood up and quoted from the scriptures. And I mentioned him in the decision and saying his sincerity of his belief is not questioned at all. But if the courts are using scriptures to interpret the Constitution, when religious people themselves can't agree on how to interpret the scriptures, we're in big trouble. And we acknowledge religion is extremely important in public life. It's a source of ethical values for many, many people who accept the Constitution because it accords with their religious beliefs. It's the source of artistic and cultural production that's been very meaningful to humanity in all sorts of different ways. And religious bodies are involved in an enormous amount of public work that's very beneficial to society in many ways, education, health, and elsewhere. We recognize that. This decision is not hostile. It's not saying that we have a cold vision of our society because we are the enlightened and you are the benighted. It emphasized that we shouldn't say opponents of same-sex marriages are bigots. That's not helpful. That's a slogan. That's a label. It's dividing the world into us and them and getting the court to draw the line between us and them. Instead of the court being able to speak in a way that encompasses everybody that they feel they listened to and respected, it's the court taking a stand, which side are you on? And it concerns me, and that's why I emphasize it so strongly in the United States, that it appears much of the impact of decisions of the Supreme Court for the last 30, 40 years because of the culture wars being called has been to separate the nation, to divide the nation, and not to find a kind of language and a style of presentation that brings people closer together. We wanted to avoid that in South Africa. And at the same time, the very constitution that recognizes the values that grant to same-sex couples the right to marry protects the rights of faith organizations not to be compelled to perform marriages that go against their beliefs. It's the same constitution. And what we need is a coexistence of different value systems where none is able to impose its position on the other. The South African Council of Churches called it a Solomonian judgment. I was very happy with that because my dad was Solly. But that, in a sense, was what I was trying to achieve. And I'm just going to conclude my conclusion with just two little stories. And the one was 2 weeks after the decision, not that Parliament passes the law, I'm driving in Kirstenbosch in Cape Town, Kirstenbosch Gardens. It's the most bourgeois family-oriented part of Cape Town. You go there for tea and scones. And I'm looking for the sign, and the sign says, to Amy and Jean's marriage. And I feel fantastic. Such a simple little sign, that's all. It's part of our normality. And Jean, who's South African, was marrying Amy, who was American, and she told me she'd actually phoned the manageress, or the manager of the place where they were having the ceremony, to book it, and then she phoned the day before and said, I ought to tell you that. We're both women, and the answer was, fantastic, you'll be the first, I'm so happy. The very last story is, I'm signing my book, Strange Alchemy of Life and All, that's got this whole story in it. And it's at the University of Cape Town, long line of people, and I see a guy, he looks a little bit familiar, don't recognize him, and as soon as he speaks, gosh, that's Advocate Smythe, very British guy, the one who was quoting from the scriptures. He says, thank you for the very kind way in which you dealt with my argument. Would you mind signing the book for me? And I felt very gratified as a judge that it had been possible to respond to such an emotive question in a manner that ended up bringing people together rather than dividing them. And so you need a value about value systems, a value that embodies and incorporates and respects diversity, but in a principled manner. And that's what we're trying so hard to achieve in South Africa. Thank you.
Albie Sachs has agreed to take some questions. We won't have a huge amount of time, but please, if you have any thoughts, comments, observations, if you have to leave, feel free to do so. Yes.
I had the interesting experience in Nicaragua and also in South Africa.
Actually, let's just wait. Yeah, yeah. Let's wait a minute.
I'm over in the linguistics department. I had the interesting experience in Nicaragua, also
I'll start for you. I had the interesting experience.
Yes. of meeting some people who had been torturers in Nicaragua, and I admired how they were handled, and I actually admired the people they had become. They were great defenders of the rights of prisoners. And I wanted to ask you how those people who had done those things in South Africa have been treated.
Okay, let me take a couple of questions.
Okay.
Let's give you the...
There's one here.
Pass me the book, please, and
I have a question both to the freedom fighter, Albie Sachs, and the judge, Albie Sachs. I wonder about the relationship you see between resistance and the law. To me, the constitution in South Africa is a fantastic and perhaps world-unique constitution, not only because of the values and its radicalness, but also because it's been so hugely influenced by the resistance. The formulation of the Freedom Charter in the 50s, where it's estimated that 1 million South Africans took part, formulated these kind of core values as we see now in the Constitution. So these kind of values that you talk about has been part of the resistance all along. But what is your view on the situation today in South Africa? When you have this radical constitution, but there are other people that are doing resistance. I'm thinking, for example, of the people living in the slums that are doing new forms of resistance against the injustices in South Africa. What's your view on the relationship between resistance and the law?
Thank you for a wonderful talk. I'm curious about how far that last principle goes. So in the United States, the debate about same-sex marriage has, as you know, been kind of fought along the same terrain about the extent of respect for tradition and religious values. And I think, you know, so far certainly legislatively, here we've been very clear to say, you know, the clergy's right to decide what kinds of couples they'll marry is their decision. And there are some people who think the right of individual conscience should go farther than that. So that people who, you know, sell photography services or wedding cakes should also have the right to refuse to serve people whose religious values don't accord with theirs, at least with regard to same-sex marriage. So how far do you think that can go?
On a completely different point, I'm wondering with respect to values, so with the denial of treatment for HIV at a period of time that resulted literally in the deaths of hundreds of thousands of South Africans. It clearly doesn't seem to be consistent with values, but since the president was the president of the country, I'm wondering how you judge, you know, bring those two together.
Okay, well, thank you. That's a very powerful bunch of questions. We had a Truth and Reconciliation Commission. Sorry, the guy was lying here. There you are. He resurrected. Yeah. Where many of the torturers were given amnesty, and the killers, and they had to. They helped us find bodies of people who disappeared, and they contributed to understanding and knowledge in the country. And the person who placed the bomb in my car went to the Truth Commission, who's from the military, and hopefully one day the film that includes him, a film about my life called Soft Vengeance, can be shown and you can get that full story. But very few went on to become active supporters of transformation and change. He helped in certain ways. As far as I can gather, I never kept up an active relationship with him. One of the heads of the hit squad is still serving a sentence because he got amnesty for a number of cases, but there were some murders. He was just going bananas, berserk, that were done for insurance and for other reasons. So he's still serving a sentence. He's trying to get amnesty now, a parole in the ordinary way. But he decided if he's going down, he's going to tell the truth. And his story is in the witness box, acknowledging what he'd done, but also saying the generals who rewarded him, who shook his hand, that became part of South African legend and understanding. There's one story that no one will forget of one Saturday afternoon. They're having a braai place, a barbecue, and drinking lots of beer, and the generals come to the farm, which was the torture, place of torture. And the medals are being handed out, and congratulations, and lots of boozing, and male camaraderie, and so on. And he said, 100 meters away, the bodies were being burnt of people who'd been tortured to death. And that sense of the fire working for joy on the one hand, and celebration, and beer drinking, and the fire destroying freedom fighters on the other. No South African will forget that. And it's a very extraordinary story, because he told the stories of the killings and the people who'd supported and rewarded him with the same detail that he'd applied to the assassinations initially. There's a very remarkable book written about interviews with him by an African psychotherapist, Pumla Kobodo Madikizela, a human being died that night, interviewing Prime Evil, the man who represented all the violence of white domination over the centuries. And she's going to interview him, armed only with a psychoanalytical understanding. It's a very amazing, very delicately phrased book, and very human, trying to see, is there a human being inside this monster? So coming out quite candidly with his responses. This woman, who is she? What does she want to know? At one stage, he moves his arm, or she moves, and she touches him. And he says to her, what's it like to touch the hand that pulled the trigger? It's a very intense kind of a book. But by and large, there hasn't been that extensive transformation of people who now have as it were, reneged on their terrible past and become promoters of dignity. But at least if they're not part and parcel of a group that's sabotaging, undermining, living in resentment, and so on, it's better for our country that we've moved on. Resistance today, of course, is resistance. And life, I think Balzac said, life is opposition. And there's a legal entitlement to resistance. It's mobilization, it's protest. But there's a huge difference. Our system is good as a constitutional system. Our basic values of our society are good. The functioning, the operation, the conduct of many individual functionaries is bad and sometimes atrocious. Under apartheid, the system was bad. The system provided no remedies. I say we, I mean, I had the vote, but I say we didn't have the vote. We didn't have democratic rights. After Sharpeville 1960, we couldn't even protest. Our organizations were banned. Armed resistance became a component, an inevitable necessary component of other forms of international pressure and public mobilization. To go in for some of the violent acts that in the earlier period was part and parcel of a massive political campaign to transform the society is completely different from today burning down schools and libraries, trashing trains. It's unacceptable. These are the trains of democracy. These are the trains that carry the people. These are the libraries of the poor in the townships. It's just not permissible. And it's got to be dealt with. How it's dealt with, that's another question. But it has to be opposed through the law and through political education. Does that mean people must put up with intolerable conditions, with abusive local councillors who are creaming it, who are giving the new houses built with public funds to their friends or to gangsters? It doesn't mean that. But I would urge people to use the mechanisms that democracy gives them. And the freedom to protest, we even had protests coming right up to the court. And we were asked as a court now, are we going to tell the police to refuse permission to people to protest outside the court? And we said no. If we believe in freedom of speech and demonstration, they must come. But they mustn't make so much noise that we can't carry on our work. We have to be able to carry on with our work, and they mustn't threaten people and bully people and stop other people from coming to the court. But sure, they can come, they can sing, and we used to hear a little bit of singing sometimes from outside. So to me, it's not the right to resist as opposed to saying we're a democratic society, resistance is now counter-revolutionary or anything. I think that's a terrible way of posing things. Of course people have the right to resist and to oppose, but they oppose within the framework. It's a very broad, expansive framework, through political action, through the vote, and if that's not getting them far enough, through litigation becomes very, very important, and it's being used quite extensively now by some of the organizations that you mentioned. We had the slum dwellers, the shack dwellers of Durban, were protesting against a law that would have allowed for slum clearance. The province was very keen. The center of many of our cities is occupied with appalling structures and buildings, old buildings that are crammed with people that haven't been renovated and cleaned up and filled with rats and fire traps. The water's been cut off. It's bad for the dignity of the city. It's unhealthy for the people living there. There has to be change. But the question is, why should the poor bear the whole burden of development and change? Provide alternative housing. Then they pass a law saying we can clear away the slums and all the ordinary laws that deal with alternative housing. That's not enough. You can't expect poor people who are being subjected to demolition of their slums to go and read up a whole lot of statutes to find out what their rights are and to get lawyers to protect them and so on. The law itself must be clear. That's part of the rule of law, that it's understood by the people who are being most affected by it. We struck down that law as being unconstitutional. I think it's important that the courts are available to take a stand against government if necessary, if corruption is chosen, is disclosed, if the appointment of people manifestly unsuited to exercising public power is irrational, that can't be justified. The courts have taken decisions in that regard. But I don't feel we can say it's okay for the poor to burn schools and libraries and public transport. It's not okay, that's not the way to go. In terms of
same-sex marriage and choice of services and same-sex marriage.
There's one other, photography.
Putting the right freedom of religion to express religious values in kind of the commercial marketplace, basically.
Oh, photographers, yes, yes, and florists, yes. We haven't had that issue, but the way I see it is Americans like to fight. And you're fighting over the details, the margins, and you're picking your fight and you're making your stand. And it's the opponents of same-sex relationships, they're making their stand. And it's the proponents who are making their stand. And they're forcing this on to the courts. And we would send these issues to the Equality Court that has a different approach of reconciliation, mediation. It's not simply saying, where do you draw the line between public power and private power? And we would want the communities themselves to find appropriate ways of resolving. The only concession that was made to the rights of conscience, if you like, of non-believers, that's non-believers now, believers who were non-believers in relation to same-sex marriage, was an indication in the judgment that I wrote to the effect that marriage officers, the legislature should consider not compelling marriage officers who were opposed to same-sex marriages to be compelled to perform them. And I can just mention my motivation, I don't remember it exactly at the time though, was more or less twofold. One was there might be real issues of conscience for honest people who joined the public service when this wasn't obligatory. Then you might say, well, people felt they could refuse to perform interracial marriages, how can they carry on? And that's a legitimate response to that. But then the second was to say, you don't want martyrs. You don't want nurses compelled to perform abortions becoming a rallying ground for opponents. The issue gets lost in the detail. Find a way to avoid that. But it went even beyond that. The idea of being married by somebody who's loathing the ceremony, I felt was awful. It's somehow the nature of the occasion. And Mark Gavisso, who married his partner, Chetty, wrote very amusingly about, well, they decided, we've been living together for years, we don't believe in showing that we are just like heterosexual couples and so on, but Chetty got a job working for UNESCO and somehow it'd be easier to get immigration papers and okay, let's get married. So they needed a reason to get married. And he said they went to the marriage officer and the guy looked like a real remnant of the old days. Body language, style, accent. Oh, you know, they made a mistake. They went to his office and they saw the office looked very funny. There were things stuck on the wall. And then suddenly this marriage officer breaks out into a smile and said, this is a most wonderful day in your lives. I hope you remember it. Very meaningful and very special. And then he says, can we see the rings? And then the rings are exchanged. And he said, would you mind if I keep the box? I've got a collection here. And those funny things in the wall were the boxes of the people who'd been married before him. And maybe this is a very South African way of doing it. But if I were in the movement here, I would probably discourage confrontation either way. But I'm not sure, you see, this is your culture, it's your way of doing things. And maybe you've got to have a demonstration outside the florist, I don't know. But to me it would be much easier just to say, look, we don't go to that guy. They're backward. There are other florists. It's not as though, I don't want to compel them. I don't want to compel them because it's the law. I can get married. I can get my flowers. I can have my cakes and so on. I can have my cake and eat it. I would take that non-confrontational stance, but then I'm not an American. I'm a South African.
Apart from eating your cake, you're eating into time to sign books, and people will have to go very soon. We have to leave the room. So there was one more question on AIDS. Do you want to answer?
Oh, yes. Very quickly. Yes. It was such a painful... Where was the person who asked? Yeah, such a painful period. And the case came to our court.
Oh, I didn't realize that there was a case.
Yeah, it came to our court.
I was thinking about it just in values and life.
No, but we had to take a stand as a court. Treatment Action Campaign, and the government restricting the provision of nevirapine, which goes to mothers about to give birth who are living with HIV, cuts, as you know, the transmission. Then it was by 50%, now it's by 90%. And the government said, we need experience in the administration, and we're going to allow it in two sites only in the public sphere, in each of the provinces. That's 18 sites. And very carefully prepared case by the Treatment Action Campaign people, one of the great civil society organizations campaigning against the position of the president, campaigning in the streets, campaigning in the press, and campaigning in the courts. And we decided unanimously that this was a denial of the right of access to adequate health care and a fundamental denial of constitutional rights. And it was a turning point. because from then onwards, the antiretroviral ARV program was rolled out, and now we have the biggest ARV program in the world. And one reason why it's so successful is this grassroots organization of people living with the virus become very active in the administration. It's not just doctors and nurses telling people, it's people in the community setting the example, ensuring there's good nutrition, ensuring there's regular taking of the medication. So what was a terrible story of totally unacceptable behavior, I wouldn't say it's become a good story overall. It's a bitter story overall. But it's through people taking action and responding produced very positive results. And when I make my presentation on that, I always end up telling the story about the judge who cried, because we'd had a case of a person applied for a job on South African Airways as a steward. He was denied the right. The court was packed with people wearing t-shirts saying HIV positive. And Sandile Ngobo, my colleague, gave the decision unanimous for the court that this was unfair discrimination based on grounds of sexual orientation. If he was fit enough, if the illness didn't prevent him from fulfilling his functions, the mere fact that there was prejudice against him was not a reason for excluding him. And the fact that British Air didn't employ people living with the virus was not a reason to allow the commercial practice of foreign airlines to dictate the fundamental rights of South Africans. A beautiful judgment. Total silence. We move out of the court and cheering starts. And I burst into tears. Not simply because of the impact of HIV in our country, but to feel I'm a member of a court that can defend fundamental rights. It was an overwhelming feeling. And now the whole scene is replicated. The Treatment Action Campaign case, Navarapine and Sandile says, Albie, would you like a hanky? We're going into court. And I say, no, I'm ready this time. And the court is jam-packed with people on the nation, HIV positive. I can't quite see that in the US Supreme Court. And Arthur Chaskelson reads the judgment of the court. Very laconic, very low-key, but in this highly charged situation, in effect, everybody knew, going against the publicly expressed opinion of the president, enormous significance and meaning. And we go out, dead silence, and the cheering starts again, and I cried again.
All right, well, I think not quite